how many of you in the audience consider yourselves a technical, mathematical kind of person? Raise your hand. How many of you consider yourselves more artistic and creative souls at heart? Cool, cool. I'm willing to bet a lot of you feel like you fundamentally belong in one or the other group. It's not uncommon when people talk about careers or academics to consider everything in either a purely artsy camp, like writing or painting, or in a purely technical camp, like STEM or trade school. You're told that you're either a free, unburdened spirit of creative energy or an Einsteinian human calculator. But I'm here to tell you that you and your human experience runs much, much deeper than that. And so can your career. More specifically, there's this often overlooked yet immensely exciting field in between these purely artistic and technical endeavors I like to call creative technology. Creative technology is not a specific job or software. It's an approach to marrying together these purely artistic and technical disciplines into something new and extraordinary. Creative technology is a spectrum. On one end, there's technology-driven art, like how movie makers use fancy equipment and software to shoot, animate, and edit their films. But far and away, my favorite example is game development. When you are making a video game, you need to not only know computer science, but also art, animation, storytelling, game design, modeling, production, marketing, so much. And it's not like each of these jobs are separate from the other. How you design your gameplay, art style, etc., informs how you structure the internal logic of your game, and ultimately changes how you actually code the game. And coding a game isn't simple. It's a common misconception that games are just as easy to make as they are to play, as if developers just drag and drop things into a game world like a kid with building blocks. When in reality, building such complex and interactive pieces of software requires top-tier problem-solving and cutting-edge computer science, even for seemingly simple, small stuff, like a video game jump. At first, you would think, just apply a little bit of upward force to your character. But then you realize, there's no gravity. But even once you add the artificial gravity, the jump feels floaty and weightless. Okay, let's think like a game designer. Floaty means that coming back down from the jump is too slow. Let's check when the velocity is negative in our jump to isolate that part and increase the gravity then, so that the player falls down faster than they come up. Okay, that's good, but we can do better. One of the building blocks of animation is adjusting timing to exaggerate or accentuate an action. We can kind of do this in our character's jump by making the player hang at the peak of their jump, like this ball does. Let's check when the velocity is small during our jump to isolate the peak and lower the gravity then, so that the player stays up there just a little bit longer. Okay, that's good. That feels like a real jump. Now, let's add some actual squash and stretch animation to our character, and voila. Aside from the inevitable bug fixing, optimization, and refactoring, this jump is good enough. There's a ton of other stuff we need to add to make this an actual game. And if coding a jump is this complex, you can imagine how much time the other stuff will take. Yes, programming games is time-consuming. Like, all my time after school, I don't do my homework time-consuming. But it's the kind of coding that feels just as much like creation as the art stuff. And it's exactly why making games is such an awesome intersection of math and art. At the end of the day, you are using all this knowledge to create something that people can enjoy. Video games have the power to bring people together, let them have fun, and even tell them stories that make them feel something deep down inside. But even if you aren't interested in making video games your career, this concept of combining the arts and technology is a movement found in a lot of different fields. Think AI, image, audio, and video generation and augmentation, which has the ability to be the ultimate stepping stone, whether that be in the creative process or with more advanced and intuitive digital tools, for artists to create whatever they want. But the end result with this tech and creative technology in general doesn't even have to be artistic. This is what I consider the other side of the spectrum, creativity-driven technology, creating technical things for a technical purpose, but in an out-of-the-box, unique, and even sort of artistic way. I've been playing around with training an AI image generator on dot plots of crashes in California so that it can spit out new dot plots and predict future crashes. It's genius because by using an image-generating model, the AI has spatial awareness in the form of pixels on an image. At the end of the day, this model needs to place dots in space. So having this inherent sense of space built into the very architecture of the model makes the machine learning far more efficient than just feeding it raw Excel spreadsheet data. The interesting thing is, I probably would never even have thought to turn the data into an image unless I had learned the basics of computer science in the tactile, visual environment that is a game engine. It just goes to show how even if you want to do something really, really technical that isn't all that artistic, like engineering, learning the basics in a more creative setting can give you a way of thinking outside the box that can be genuinely special. Perhaps learning engineering through one of the many architecture courses we have at this school, or basically anywhere, can really help you tackle problems in a novel way when they inevitably arise in your career. Because to create all the wacky stuff you desire in an architecture class, you need to go through a lot of unique challenges. And challenges are how we grow. And who knows? Maybe you'll enjoy architecture and pursue it and create stuff that's truly technical artistry, like that dome in Las Vegas, which is not only a technical marvel made with the most advanced engineering, but also a thing of art and beauty that entertains. I seriously recommend checking out their website. They actually have a page called Art and Science, and it goes into great detail about how they use math to make the sphere come to life. And architecture is just one example. Within engineering and other fields, there are many, many of these creative pockets where you can learn the same, if not more, skills in your desired field than usual as well as those skills in the aforementioned creative thinking space. And if you don't like any of the fields that exist right now, make your own. We are living in an enlightened age for technology's relationship with art and entertainment, and we need more people to lead the way in this blossoming space. We spend all this time in school learning math, English, science, history, as if they are these separate topics, and we carry that notion in our minds long after we graduate. But it's only when we explore where these domains come together that true innovation will be unleashed. Think about this. When all the pencil pushing, cubicle, bean counting busy work is taken care of by AI, and it will be someday because it's the only thing machine learning is really good at, what will we humans be left to do? Well, AI is derivative by its very nature. It can't come up with something it hasn't already been inundated with before. This means that art, originality, and creation are truly the only uniquely human things. And we have to stop acting like they're useless. We have to stop acting like art is simply a decoration to humanity's technological history. But we also have to stop acting like technology is this cold, harsh beast. We have to stop acting like there's this left brain, right brain division between our creative and logical selves. We have to stop acting like it's art or technology, like they are these separate paths in life and that there's some rivalry or choice between one or the other. It's both. It's always been both. You can do both, and you should do both.